nistalim dadur nipa Vaishnavis. Gandharvan, unto the Gandharvas, Upadhava, go take shelter, Imam, these, Tubhyam, unto you, Dasyanti, will deliver, Mam iti, exactly like me, or me factually. Tasya, by him, samstuvataha, offering prayers, tushta, being satisfied, agnistalim, a girl produced from fire, dadu, delivered, nirpa, O king, urvashim, urvashi, Manyamana, thinking, tam, her, saha, he, pururava, charan, while walking, vane, in the forest. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami, Srila Prabhupada, Jaya Srila Prabhupada. Translation, Urvashi said, my dear king, seek shelter of the Gandharvas, for they will be able to deliver me to you again. In accordance with these words, the king satisfied the Gandharvas by prayers, and the Gandharvas, being pleased with him, gave him an Agnistali girl, who looked exactly like Urvashi. Thinking that the girl was Urvashi, the king began walking with her in the forest. But later, he could understand that she was not Urvashi, but Agnistali. Purport. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur remarks that Pururava was very lusty. Immediately after getting the Agnistali girl, he wanted to have sex with her. But during sexual intercourse, he could understand that the girl was Agnistali, not Urvashi. This indicates that every man attached to a particular woman knows the particular characteristics of that woman during sex life. Thus, Pururava understood during sexual intercourse that the Agnistali girl was not Urvashi. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purport to Canto 9, Chapter 14, in the matter of King Pururava enchanted by Urvashi, Text 42. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Gyananjana Shlakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurve Namaha. Shri Chaitanya Manobishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamahyam Dadati Svapadantikam. Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sagana Ragunatan Vitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Saitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sagana Lalita Shri Vishakan Vitamscha Namaum Vishnupadaya Krishna Preshtaya Bhutale Srimate Jayapataka Swaminiti Namine Nama Acharya Padaya Nitai Kripa Pradayine Gauragata Damadaya Nagara Gramatarine Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshtaya Bhutale Srimate Gopi Paranadana Dase Iti Namine Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshtaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Pashyatya Deshatharine Vanchakalpattarubhyascha Kripasindubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadhadara Srivasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare Mukam Karoti Vachalam Pangum Langayate Girim Yat Kripatamaham Bande Shri Gurudanitarinam Yat Kripatamaham Bande Paramananda Madhavam Shri Chaitanya Ishwaram Katanchana smrite yasmin dushkaram sukaram bhavet vismrite vipritam syat Sri Chaitanyam namamitam. Okay, so we just finished, we just celebrated Lord Nityananda's appearance day yesterday. And Vrindavan Das Thakur, while glorifying Lord Nityananda, he describes that Lord Nityananda would walk like a maddened elephant, maddened by the intoxication of love of God. It's a very beautiful poetic description. So I was thinking that from the intoxication of love of God, today we are dealing with the intoxication of material life, the madness of material life. I'll come back to Lord Nityananda's intoxication a little bit later. But first let me deal with this particular thing that Prabhupada is talking about here. And this particular section of the Bhagavatam. It's interesting that Prabhupada was the only person, if you actually look at it, among all the gurus who have come, all the different teachers who have come, who could boldly say that everybody in this world is mad. He didn't give credit to any advancement or any advancement of material civilization or any so-called knowledge. He simply said that everybody is mad. That's actually a fact. So I was just thinking that there are a few interesting conversations with Prabhupada, quite humorous. So let me begin with a few of them. This is a lecture where Prabhupada is speaking about from the Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya Lila chapter 25, text 36 to 40. This is on the 23rd of Jan 1967 in San Francisco. Generally, people, they are mad because more or less, then he says, not more or less, practically every one of us, we are mad. Why mad? Pramatta. This is a word that is used in the Bhagavatam. This word is used, pramatta. Pramatta means mad. Nunam pramatta kurute vikarma. We are thinking that I am this body, and therefore a little sense gratification, because the body means there are different senses, and if we can gratify the senses, we think that we are happy. This is madness. Rishabhadev says, Nunam pramatta kurute vikarma yad indriya pritya pritaya apranoti. It's from Bhagavatam 5.5.4. So, Prabhupada was very fond of speaking strongly, and then he would say, I'm not saying this, Bhagavatam is saying it. Like here he's saying, Bhagavatam is using it. Similarly, when he would say that anybody who does not surrender unto Krishna, they belong to the four categories. Duskrita, Duskritina, Muda, Maya Parata Jnana, and Muda? Naradhama, yes. So, here Prabhupada is saying everybody is mad. And then he quotes the Bhagavatam, Rishabhdev's teachings. Now, it is interesting that throughout the history of Vedic literatures, not only history of Vedic literatures, but throughout human history, what we find is people have tried to gratify their senses in various ways. But all of them, without exception, have failed miserably. And this is one such story of such miserable failure. And you can see, as we go through this chapter, we see how greatly entangled Pururava gets because of his attraction for Urvashi. He gets completely entangled in material life. Therefore, Prabhupada refers it to as madness. And this is not just applicable to Pururava, but for every conditioned soul who identifies with the body. This is true that we're all mad. As Prabhupada would say, it's only a question of degree. To what degree are we mad? But the fact is, we are mad. And Prabhupada is bold enough to say it. And there's another conversation, and this is pretty interesting. It's a morning walk, where Prabhupada says, this is on the 19th of September, 1972, location, Los Angeles. Prabhupada, Pramatta means mad, crazy. All of them, crazy. Noonam Pramatta Kurute Vikarma. So what do you say, Karandar Prabhu? Karandar, oh. And then Prabhupada jokes, Prabhupada, you are a great supporter of the materialists. Srirup Damodar laughs. Now what is your answer? Prabhupada is asking. Karandar, they'll say the body may be only source of pain, but it is also the only source of pleasure according to their. So Karandar is trying to say that, okay, they'll say the body may be the only source of pain, but it's also the only source of pleasure. So what's wrong? That's their whole idea. Prabhupada, that is not pleasure. You're creating another pain. This is the nonsense. Karandar, but they're willing for every pleasure. Prabhupada, just like a camel. Camel is drinking his own blood and he's thinking, I'm enjoying. That pleasure is like that. Just like when you have sex enjoyment, you're spoiling your blood and you're thinking, I'm enjoying. Swarup Damodar, because the camel does not understand. Prabhupada, yes. Swarup Damodar, that blood is coming out from its own mouth. Prabhupada, yes. Therefore, that is not pleasure. That proves that you are a camel. So Prabhupada had very, very strong Shastric arguments to prove whatever he was saying. And we know that according to Ayurveda, semen is nothing but blood transformed. So there is a lot of loss of blood due to sexual activity. And Prabhupada compares that to the pleasure that a camel gets by eating thorns. Because when the camel eats thorns, it cuts the tongue of the camel and the blood oozes from the tongue, and mixed with the thorn, it creates a certain taste and the camel enjoys the taste. So therefore Prabhupada says, that proves that you are a camel. And Krishna also explains this sequence in the Bhagavad Gita, Dhyayato Vishaya Pumshan, which it says that beginning by thinking of the, in the 62nd verse of the second chapter, he speaks about it, that by thinking of the objects of the senses, this is how it begins, by thinking of the objects. And how do you think you begin to, usually it starts with hearing. So therefore there is a lot of propaganda to make you think. There's a lot of propaganda. So when you start thinking, then you develop attachment. Then what happens? And from attachment, lust develops. Sangat sanjayate kaman. So then lust develops. Then when lust is not satisfied, then anger. Lust is not satisfied due to some obstacle by someone or something, then anger. And from anger, Krishna explains that samoha starts. Samoha is bewilderment. You don't know, you get bewildered. What is the right thing to do? What is the wrong? What is the right thing and what is the wrong thing? You get bewildered. That's called samoha. Due to anger, it produces samoha. And what does samoha do? It produces smriti virbhrama, which means that you don't know what is beneficial. You forget that smriti virbhrama means you forget. Loss of memory means you forget what is good for you and what is bad for you. So we begin to lose sense of what is good for us, what is bad for us. And then what happens? Buddhinashaha. Buddhinashaha means our resolve to practice spiritual life gets destroyed. So this is the normal sequence of events that happen. It's a very progressive sequence. Therefore, Prabhupada said that there is thinking, there is feeling, and there is willing. So if you stop things at the stage of thinking, then feeling and willing can be stopped. Therefore, Prabhupada laid a lot of emphasis on reading his books. Because when you read his books, it orients your thinking. And when your thinking is all right, your feelings and your actions will naturally follow. So therefore, for the members of the Krishna Consciousness Movement, it is necessary, it is mandatory, it is compulsory to hear from Prabhupada through his books every day. Because only that keeps our thinking intact. We may think, okay, what is the harm? We are practicing devotional service. So even if you don't read, but it makes a difference. Just like when you go out on a road, suppose you're riding on a two-wheeler and you're wearing some very clean cloth, and you may be doing your business of riding, but without your desire, without your intention, still your cloth is going to get soiled. That is the nature of things in this material world, that by its very nature, there are always going to be some impurities. So we have to cleanse our consciousness every day through the words emanating from Prabhupada's books. And that is what is going to keep us fixed and properly in our... So we don't fall into that. When buddhinasha happens, then we fall into samsara. To avoid falling into... Once we get into Krishna consciousness, Prabhupada says, there is no need to fall down actually. So if we just hold on to the lotus feet of Prabhupada through the words emanating from his books, then we don't have to be getting into this kind of madness. And Prabhupada also explains that this whole material thing, this whole material attraction is, Prabhupada actually graphically explains how it is madness. In the Bhakti Godhead magazine, an article published in 1958, which is also published in the book Science of Self-Realization, Prabhupada actually brings out the underlying feature of human sexuality. So there he tells the story of a man who was attracted by a woman. A young man was attracted by a young woman, and she was a saintly woman. And because it was getting, his advances were getting difficult, so the girl told him, yes, I will fulfill your desires, but give me a week's time. And okay, he thought, okay, week is now, okay, it's okay. So what she did during this week was that she started taking laxatives and purgatives. So due to which, for 1 week, she had diarrhea and she would vomit. And Prabhupada says that she stored all these in pots. And I'll read a bit of that section little while later. So there, and then what happens is that after a week, when the man comes to see this girl, he cannot recognize her. And she's become emaciated, and then the complexion of her skin is completely vanished, and her eyes have sunk into their sockets. And so he asks her, where is that beautiful girl that I was supposed to meet? And she tells him that I am that same girl, and just that I've separated the ingredients of my beauty. And let me just read what Prabhupada says there. So Prabhupada says, okay. At last the girl told the powerful man that she had separated the ingredients of her beauty and stored them in pots. She also told him that he could enjoy those juices of beauty. When the mundane poetic man asked to see those juices of beauty, when the mundane poetic man asked to see those juices of beauty, he was directed to the store of loose stool. Initially, she didn't tell him what she did. She just said that I've stored my beauty in some pots. So he was eager to see it, and so Prabhupada says, he was directed to the store of loose stool and liquid vomit, which were emanating an unbearably bad smell. Thus, the whole story of the beauty liquid was disclosed to him. Finally, by the grace of the saintly girl, this man of low character was able to distinguish between shadow and substance, and thus he came to his senses. Okay, now we may say, okay, this story is okay, but in reality, just by hearing a story, people don't change like that. You know, of course, this man in experience, but even if we hear the story, it may not ring a bell, at least if we are in the initial stages of Krishna consciousness. So, now let me come back to Lord Nityananda. So, it said that Lord Nityananda walked around like a maddened elephant, intoxicated by love of Godhead. Now, Prabhupada writes, actually my folio crashed. So, I couldn't get all the references, but you can look it up. Prabhupada explains that by the mercy of Lord Nityananda, being empowered by Lord Nityananda, one can do even more than Lord Nityananda did. Very interesting. And if you look at the life of Srila Prabhupada, he also walked like a maddened elephant across the whole world, distributing love of Godhead. And why did he succeed? Why did he succeed? And what was the secret of that success? And in the Bhagavatam, Prabhupada in one purport, in the second canto, he brings that whole thing, the entire story of ISKCON, he brings out in one particular purport. So I'll just read that here. It's a very interesting purport. This is from the second canto, chapter 4, text 5. This is the entire history of ISKCON, just in one purport. Samichinam vacho brahman sarvagnyasya tavagnaha tamo vishiryate mahiyan hare katayataha katam. Translation, Maharaj Parikshit said, O learned Brahmana, you know everything because you are without material contamination. Therefore, whatever you have spoken to me appears perfectly right. Your speeches are gradually destroying the darkness of my ignorance. For you are narrating the topics of the Lord. Purport. The practical experience of Maharaj Parikshit is disclosed herein, revealing that the transcendental topics of the Lord act like injections. When they are received by the sincere devotee from a person who is perfectly uncontaminated by material tinges. In other words, reception of the messages of Srimad Bhagavatam from professional men heard by a Karmakandiya audience never acts miraculously as stated here. Devotional hearing of the messages of the Lord is not like ordinary hearing topics. Therefore, the action will be felt by the sincere hearer by experience of the gradual disappearance of ignorance. Yasya deve para bhaktir yata deve tatagro tasete katite hai artaha prakashante mahatmanaha. Svetashvatara Upanishad 6:23. When a hungry man is given food to eat, he feels satiation of hunger and the pleasure of dining simultaneously. Thus he does not have to ask whether he has actually been fed or not. The crucial test of hearing Srimad Bhagavatam is that one should get positive enlightenment by such an act. This is exactly what happened. When Prabhupada reached the shores of America, he writes in his poem, how will this audience understand the mellows of devotional service? Then he prays to Krishna, therefore please make my power of speaking suitable for their understanding. So this is what Prabhupada did. He was carrying love of God like a maddened elephant across the whole world. And when he would speak, he would inject that madness into the ears of his listeners. And all that they had to do was just have that faith. And I remember some years ago, now you don't have that anymore. In Sri Lanka, you had what is called the LTTE, Liberation Tigers of Tamil Eelam. They were fighting for, their origins were in South India, but they had settled down in Sri Lanka, and they're fighting the government for their own country in Sri Lanka. And so they had a lot of these, they had these guerrilla warfare, and they had the suicide bombers. So the suicide bombers, if the army would capture the suicide bombers, they would immediately take a pill of cyanide. Cyanide is so potent that just within a few seconds you'll be dead. So that is the potency of cyanide, something material. Prabhupada also speaks about cyanide in one place, that it's a small thing, but it has instant effect throughout the whole body. So that is the nature of hearing from someone like Prabhupada, that it is stronger than cyanide. All that it takes is, as Prabhupada explains here, that yasya deve para bhaktir, one who has implicit faith in both the spiritual master and the scriptures, spiritual master and the scripture, as long as you think they're non-different, then instantly it works. And that is the story of ISKCON, that one by one, people began to hear from Prabhupada, and that hearing, as Prabhupada is speaking about, using the word miraculous effect, it had a miraculous effect because of the fact that Prabhupada is injecting that love of God through the ears of his hearers. And when Prabhupada came to India, especially in Mayapur, his godbrothers would criticize his disciples because they didn't know all the Western tradition, Indian traditions, the Vedic traditions, the different aspects of Vedic culture and things like that. But Prabhupada, while speaking to his godbrothers, he would proudly, while introducing Mother Malati, he proudly said, my disciples, they may not have all the different qualities and all the different, they may not know so much about Vedic culture, like those born, fortunate to be born in India may know. But he said, but they have one good quality. Whatever I say, they do. And then he said, this is Malati. And she said, and he said, she can cut her throat for me, and I can cut my throat for her. So this is the secret of ISKCON's success, that those who took to Prabhupada's teachings believed in him 100%, and they didn't know anything else. And that is the success story of ISKCON. So if we have that same attitude when we study his books and we study his teachings, that same injection, Prabhupada is there. Prabhupada said, my books are my personal ecstasies. So he's present in the books. And Prabhupada also says how you can see that he's present in his books. So we have the four regulative principles. Normally we think, okay, the four regulative principles are moral principles. We have to follow some morality. Therefore these principles are there. But Prabhupada explains in the Bhagavatam that these principles, the four regulative principles that we follow, are not just some moral principles. They are actually principles of cognition. principles of a clear consciousness. And Prabhupada explains, I won't go into the whole text and the translation purport. This is from 1344. Prabhupada writes, no one can give, this is about hearing the Bhagavatam with rapt attention. No one can give rapt attention one who is not pure in mind. No one can be pure in mind who is not pure in action. And no one can be pure in action who is not pure in eating, sleeping, fearing and mating. So there it is. So no one can give rapt attention to the Bhagavatam if one is not pure in mind. Purity in mind means you have to be pure in action. And pure in action means you have to be pure in eating, sleeping, mating and defending. Therefore, the four regulative principles are not just some moral principles. They're also essential principles of cognition. But somehow, Prabhupada ends that purport by saying, but somehow or other, if someone hears with rapt attention from the right person, at the very beginning, one can assuredly see Lord Sri Krishna in person, in the pages of the Bhagavatam. So Prabhupada writes this, then he says, but somehow or the other. So even if we have not reached the perfectional stage of following all the four regulative principles in its entirety, in thought, word, deed, still, if somehow or the other, so somehow or the other, if you try to listen to Prabhupada, then assuredly you can see Krishna in person, he writes, in every page of the Bhagavatam. And when you say see Krishna, of course, Krishna is with his pure devotees. It also means that you can see Prabhupada in every page of the Bhagavatam. So, and Prabhupada, in the previous purport that I spoke about, Prabhupada is speaking about the crucial test of hearing Srimad Bhagavatam is that one should get positive enlightenment by such an act. And he gives the example of feeling satiated feel satiation of hunger and the pleasure of dining simultaneously. This is again from the Bhagavatam, which says that when you are hungry and you eat, what happens? You feel your hunger being satisfied and you also feel the pleasure of eating. And Prabhupada repeatedly, if you look at his teachings, repeatedly he says, this is the test, this is the test, this is the test, this is the test, repeatedly, again and again and again. So which means that for us, practically, and Prabhupada also explains what it means. He says that our attraction for Krishna should increase, as Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur would say, artha pravritti, and our attraction for material life should decrease. So we are transferring from one kind of madness to another kind of madness, from the madness of material entanglement to the madness of loving Krishna. So we should be able to tangibly see that. We are developing that madness more and more, and we are decreasing this madness more and more. The madness of Krishna consciousness we are increasing. Prabhupada in fact once said it, our movement is meant for becoming mad after Krishna. So this is the test, that our madness for hearing the Bhagavatam is increasing, and our madness for hearing mundane topics is decreasing. Or our madness for Krishna consciousness, attraction for Krishna consciousness is increasing, and our attraction for material life is decreasing. And Prabhupada would also give the example of the Bhagavatam speakers. Like for example, in Vrindavan, during Kartik especially, there are so many Bhagavat Kathas. And even if we go to those Kathas, if we hear the description, maybe we may cry also, because they describe in a very nice manner. But that is not enough. Because Prabhupada said the test is, what would happen if you go home? What would they have been, okay, for 1 week or whatever is their saptaha period, or even they fast for some time during Kartik. But once they go back, then they think, okay, when will I resume my normal life? When will I resume my non-vegetarian food? When will I be able to drink alcohol? So where is the effect of hearing Bhagavatam? So this, the real effect is that when you hear Bhagavatam, then your attraction for material life will decrease. And here in this chapter, we are especially speaking about sex life. And Prabhupada repeatedly said this, that the test is our attraction for sex and sex life should decrease. And Jananivas Prabhu once told the story that he was at Prabhupada in his room in Mayapur, in his rooms in the Lotus building. And when Prabhupada is describing Yamunacharya's relishing Nava Nava Rasa by engaging in Krishna service. And so Ramanacharya sings that when he thinks of sex life, his lips curl in disgust and he spits at that thought. And so Janivas Prabhu said, when Prabhupada is speaking about it, when he said that I spit at that thought, Prabhupada actually spat. And it flew across the room. Janivas Prabhu was saying it flew across the room in slow motion. And so this is the test. So how do we know? I mean, how does it relate to us? We should be able to see it. That, let's say 10 times out, okay, let's say on a scale of 10, how many times do our lips curl in disgust, and how many times do we spit at the thought of sex and sex life? That is the test. Prabhupada says it actually. So, I mean, if it is one time, good. I mean, at least that's something. 2, 3, 4, whatever. So you cannot, that's why Prabhupada says that nobody needs to give you a certificate in Krishna consciousness. You can know whether you're advancing or not. Sometimes devotees, I remember, they would come and tell me, oh, I knew this devotee, he was very serious, he fell down, he had this problem. But I often tell them, how does it matter? You're following Prabhupada's teachings, you don't experience Krishna consciousness? And Prabhupada says, you don't need somebody else to test. I mean, you can test it yourself, whether your attraction for Krishna is increasing and whether attraction for Maya is decreasing. So that we have an objective way of testing also. How much has our attraction for Maya decreased and how much has our attraction for Krishna increased? So before Prabhupada went to the West, people thought that even among the Gaudiya Mats, they believed then that Lord Chaitanya says, Prithivite Achay Ratanagradi Gram, perhaps it refers to the whole of India. Because even Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur had sent people to the West and they had not really succeeded. So, but Prabhupada actually showed that this madness of Krishna consciousness can actually be transmitted. And as Prabhupada writes, by the mercy of Lord Nityananda, one can do even more than what Lord Nityananda did. Lord Nityananda, you have the story of Jagai and Madai. But Prabhupada has delivered hundreds and thousands of Jagai and Madai. So that is by the mercy of Lord Nityananda. And he said this, the secret of my success was, whatever my spiritual master said, I believed in it 100%. When Prabhupada asked, what is the secret of his success? He would repeatedly say this, that I believed, whatever my spiritual master said, I believed. He would say, I don't know Krishna, but I know my spiritual master, and he knows Krishna. And this was the secret of his success. So if we, in our lives, if we have to be successful in Krishna consciousness, successful means we developing attraction for Krishna. Our success is defined as twofold success. One is, we should ourselves develop love for Krishna. And our mandate, Chaitanya Manobishtam, Prabhupada, Bhakti Siddhanta, our mandate is, we should not only become happy ourselves, but we should also spread this happiness and spread Krishna consciousness across the world. And Prabhupada was the one who showed it, that Lord Chaitanya's prediction in the Bhagavatam, in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, is actually true. It can actually happen. Of course, nowadays you have so many others going to the West, but it is a fact that it was Prabhupada who established Krishna consciousness in the West, and everybody else, whether we like it or not like it, everybody else is riding on that wave of Prabhupada's mercy. So, we may think that, if you actually look at it, the whole world is mad after material life. And here is Prabhupada, a 70-year-old gentleman, going into America, right into the heart of America, and being with the very young people and convincing them there is a greater attraction than the attraction of material life. This is Prabhupada, the master at whose feet everybody else sits. So therefore, there is in our Krishna consciousness movement, as Prabhupada would say, our Krishna consciousness movement is full of hope. And one symptom of a follower of Prabhupada is that a follower of Prabhupada would always be absorbed in the intoxication of love of God. Of course, even if one has not attained love of Godhead, but still it is very much possible for one to be always happy. Lord Chaitanya, when he says Anandambudhi Vardhanam, or when Lochandas Thakur sings Keval Ananda Kanda, these are not exaggerations, but rather by following Prabhupada's teachings on a day-to-day basis, we can also experience that happiness. And when people come in contact with us, sometimes we think so much about preaching strategies, this strategy, that strategy. It is not a strategy. It is injection of Krishna consciousness. So if we take to Prabhupada's teaching seriously, then there is no way that we can be unhappy. We are helplessly happy if we follow his teachings. And when we are helplessly happy, we can inject that happiness into the ears of our listeners. And so, I think I would like to stop there. And with what Ravindra Swarup Prabhu one ends in one lecture, in one of his essays, it's called Celibacy, Exquisite Torture, or Love of God. I mean, what is it? Yes to God. Exquisite Torture or Yes to God. What he writes an essay after meeting a group of Christian priests. He goes and meets them in their seminary. And everybody is practically struggling with celibacy, you know. And then he feels very sad seeing the situation. And he feels that how fortunate that we are, that Prabhupada has given us such a taste for Krishna consciousness. And then he ends that by saying, some of us have been fortunate to meet a pure devotee. We have not been betrayed. Okay, so this is our great fortune. And it's there for everybody to take it. And if we can just take that, then, as I said, we can only be helplessly happy. Okay. If there are any comments or questions, because I was told you should end by 9 o'clock. Okay. Yes, Matsuji. Mike. Okay.
Hare Krishna, thank you for your class. I was just thinking that if madness, in order for madness to have meaning, then sanity must also exist. So, but if the non-devotees are mad and devotees are mad, who's sane?
Oh, good. Good question. So, our madness is the most exalted state of sanity. That is how our madness is defined. Because that madness is all good. It is all good producing madness. So it is not madness in the dictionary definition of the term. Because that madness has a connotation of something which is negative. But when Prabhupada uses the term madness, it refers to a madness which is the most elevated state of sanity. Krishna Prema is the most elevated state of sanity. It's called, Prabhupada said, only a pure devotee is normal. Everybody else is not normal. In fact, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, he says that our only business is to follow the pure devotees. And then he says, but the people in this world trying to follow a pure devotee, I mean, what is this? We're trying to be servants. We use this word so often. Servant, begging, falling at the feet. All these things may appear very, lack of some dignity, you know. And then Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur says in his expression, let the censorious people calumniate us to their heart's content, he says. Censorious people means these people who judge. And we will not mind them, he says. Let us roll in the dust and forget everything in the ecstasy of intoxication by drinking the strong and tasty wine of love of Lord Hari, he says. So this kind of madness is what we aspire for. It is more and more refined levels of sanity. I would say, call it like that. Yes, probably. Thinking, feeling, and willing. Yes. Okay.
Just like you also mentioned that. To be pure in thoughts, we need to be pure in action. And to be pure in action, so it seems other way around that unless we are pure in our action, our thinking will not become pure.
Yeah. Good point. I mean, I thought that this question may come up. So there are two things which Prabhupada speaks about. In the earlier purport that I read, so Prabhupada is speaking about hearing from a pure devotee. Okay. And when you hear from a pure devotee, there is an injection of Krishna consciousness. And that, when we say thinking, okay, so our conditioned nature, by our conditioned nature, we have a certain process of thinking. But when we hear from a pure devotee, we have to replace our normal thinking, whatever is that normal, with the thoughts expressed by a pure devotee. And Prabhupada says, then we begin to get elevated. And the pure devotee says, you do this, try to follow these principles. Okay? And when we follow these principles, it's a combination. How do you do it? I mean, it's like Bhaktisiddhanta Sasi Thakur said, our philosophy is like the rope in the well. He said, like there are two Vaishnava systems of thought. One is the kitten philosophy, one is the monkey philosophy. The kitten is carried by the cat everywhere. And the monkey, the baby monkey has to hold on to the mother monkey. These are two opposites. One is by your own endeavor, one is simply by the mercy of the Lord. So Bhaktisiddhanta Sasi Thakur said that our process is rope in the well philosophy. So Krishna throws the spiritual master throws the rope and you hold on to that rope. So Prabhupada is giving us instruction. At the same time, we have to just make the effort to hold on to that instruction. And by a combination. So gradually, it becomes, I understand what you're saying. But the point is, as long as that's why Prabhupada says, so some more or the other, if one can hear. That's why he says that expression. Otherwise, he would not use the expression, some more or the other. You know, so some more or the other, if you can just hold on to what Prabhupada is saying, then we're rightly situated. That's why if you look at the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, Nectar of Upadeshamrita, there it says about tolerating the urges first. Everything begins with tolerating. At least by hearing the words of a pure devotee, you develop the ability to tolerate. Because otherwise you're hopelessly lost. So we are following the regulative principles, we may not be free from those desires. Our lips may not curl in disgust at the beginning of practice. But gradually we can see that happening. Okay, I think it's 9 o'clock, so if those who want to go can go. Others, I can answer.
Thank you so much, Prabhu. The other point is interesting is, even a very advanced devotee, sometimes the thought comes.
Okay.
So, you were saying that the thought comes. So, when the actions are purer and purer, then the thought will never come at all, ultimately.
Yes, if for those who are situated in love of Godhead, they're fully under yoga maya, so there's no question of such things coming up in their minds. But for practitioners, yes, but the it gradually diminishes, or at least the distaste is so strong that you don't care about it. Srimad Bhagavatam ki jaya, Srila Prabhupada ki jaya.